luxury lifestyle, tech tools, toys, news, hot jazz, passionate living with your host and curator, Zenobia, the touchable tech diva. And now, tech diva and the luxury lifestyle and Zenobia, the touchable tech diva.
Hello, hello, hello. Welcome, welcome. I'm going to have to do something really nice for Dawn because I sent her through a bunch of hoops this morning. Anyway, welcome, tech diva and the luxury lifestyle. I'm going to jam in a whole lot of stuff today and enjoy the music. I'll be right back.
Thank you.
But for you newbies, okay, I'm Zenobia, the Touchable Tech Diva. I'm your host and curator here at Tech Diva and the Luxury Lifestyle. Tech tools, toys, news, hot jazz, passionate living, and all kinds of cool things having to do with lifestyle and living. I've been really focused on the security thing, as most of my usual audience knows, and there's just so much stuff, so I'm still gonna do that for probably a few more shows, and then as I'm lining up some other really, really cool stuff and diversify. You know, they say you're supposed to diversify, and I'm a Gemini, I'm supposed to be really good at diversifying. So that's what I'll be doing. I've met some really cool people that have some really, really interesting things. You know, we kind of get in our kind of groove, and sometimes we don't veer out of that groove to find out that there's all kinds of other really cool stuff going on. And you know, I'm such a jazz addict that I kind of stay in that lane a lot, and I'm a geek, so I do a lot of geek stuff. But at the same time, knowing all of that and doing all of that, those are my passions. And yes, I am sharing my passions, and I get to talk about my passions. But a lot of my passions are about helping you to have a better world. I'm trying to make your world better by talking about technology and talking about these things that impact us, so that you'll know what's going on and you can adjust your lifestyle accordingly and become more efficient, actually using technology, just taking it on. We have to take it on, not fear it, but take it on. And with my assistance curating and handpicking some of the topics and as well as services and technologies are out there, you know, to help you to craft your lifestyle and be more efficient so you can have more time to do your passion. And if you don't know what it is, you'll get some ideas about doing something very passionate, because to me, passion is a new survival tool. We have to have that as an offset to all that other daily in your lane stuff that we end up having to do. Okay, so music wise you just heard Low Rider, and that was Warren Hill playing sax there, and that's from Pop Jazz. And opening up the show, a cover for one of my favorite R&B artists, Funkadelic, The Parliament and Funkadelic, and that was One Nation Under a Groove, and that was Gordon James from Enjoy. Okay, we're gonna do a little bit more music, and then yes, I have some a few topics here, and about this whole security thing with what Silicon Valley is now radicalizing. Silicon Valley is now becoming radicalized, believe it or not. And that's all with this whole cybersecurity thing. So, coming up, something I rarely do, Summer Breeze. And we got some summer weather here happening in Southern California right now, and we're about to head into the Northern Hemisphere summer. Okay, so here's a little tune to get you started. Zenobia here, the Touchable Tech Diva, Tech Diva and the Luxury Lifestyle, Tech Tools, Toys, News, Hot Jazz, Passionate Living. See you in a bit. Okay, jazz covers of R&B hits. That's the theme of the music today, if you hadn't figured it out. So, Everything I Miss at Home. And that was George Howard. Rest in peace, George. Long time ago, left a nice body of work. And that's from the GRP and K-Ace 103.9 FM presents the smooth sounds of jazz. And that's a CD from a CD that I've probably had for 20-some years, where a local radio station here actually, and this was what radio stations used to do back in the 80s and the 90s, was when there were CDs. Remember CDs, any of you? Remember CDs, audio CDs? Well, that was a nice promotional thing and also a moneymaker for radio stations to actually put a compilation CD together with a bunch of, you know, tunes that they curated. We didn't call it that back then, but that's what they did. So they hand selected some really popular tunes and then branded it with their station and either gave them away for promotions or they would sell them and make a little bit of money on it. It wasn't a lot of money, but if they had really popular tunes, and of course they had all the licensing deals, so they didn't run into licensing issues. And so this was one that K-Ace, if you're from LA and old school, you would remember K-Ace FM. And they put together several of them, and so some really, really cool tunes. Okay, so opening up the set, Summer Breeze. I said, I'm getting you ready for summer, although Don was talking about I have a lot of slow songs today and you all should be really chilled out. Okay, Summer Breeze, Waymon Tisdale, and Rest in Peace. This is my tribute section's selection here, and that's from In the Zone. Yeah, Waymon was a bass man, so I have a lot of his stuff because, you know, I'm the bass girl and I love bass. Okay, a couple of things that I'm going to run through. And I mentioned at the top of the show that Silicon Valley is becoming radicalized. Well, part of what is driving this, and to give you a little bit of backstory, you remember a few months ago, the federal government took Apple to court to get Apple to actually write a new piece of code for an iPhone for the iOS 7 so that they could jailbreak or crack open a cell phone of a terrorist or a suspected terrorist that was killed in San Bernardino. So I think the whole planet knows about what happened in San Bernardino with this couple that supposedly were terrorists, but they were trying to crack open one of them's phone to see if there were any other people that they could identify on the phone that might have had a relationship with. And so Apple said, no, we're not going to do it. And what happens with the all the phones, even on Android phones, but here on the Apple in the Apple ecosystem, that is the mobile ecosystem, that's the cell phones, the tablets, and also the laptops, but especially the cell phone and the tablets, all the iPads, all of those, and the iPods. With that operating system, if you put in the wrong password 10 times, then it will erase. Okay, so let me back up a little bit because you know, on the iPhone you can set how long the phone will stay on, okay, before it goes to sleep. Okay, then it requires that you put that password in again. So I had a client whose show I actually went on and I talked about this, and one question, she asked me a lot of questions, and one of the questions was, how do I make my phone stay on? Because it keeps going off and I want it to just stay on. And I said, you can't. Okay, and but I said that you can adjust how long it stays on, but it maxes out at 5 minutes. So on the iPhone, it will stay on for 5 minutes, then it will go to sleep. Okay, and then when you turn it back on, you have to put the password in, because she said she was tired of having to enter the password. Well, it's for your own security that they build that in. And so, as I mentioned, yeah, you can put in the wrong password 10 times and then, you know, you can't get into it anymore. Okay, it just locks out and then it's toast. So Apple doesn't even store the passwords, and they really don't have a back door to override that, because they want to, you know, their customers to be safe and secure, and they don't even store those passwords. Whatever password you put in, they don't know what it is. Okay, so, but there is a way to write some code. You could write code to override that, and Apple refused to. And so that's when the feds, they said, no, we're not going to do it. We're not going to write that code. So it turns out that the feds found a hacker. Now, remember, I talk about hackers, and there are white hat hackers, and there are black hat hackers. Okay, so the white hat hackers are the good guys who will try to break code and write code, to hack into your system, and they're on the good side. You know, the dark web, the dark web hackers are the ones that wreak havoc with us, and that's why I spend a lot of time on this to try and, we can't keep ahead of them at this point, we're trying, but at least we can do some things to mitigate. Anyway, so I'm not sure if the feds hired a white hat or a black hat hacker. Anyway, they paid somebody money to go in there and found a vulnerability to where they could write code, and they hacked into the phone. But it was only written for that specific phone. I think it was a 5C, an iPhone 5C that was on iOS 7. Okay, so the hacker wrote some code so they could actually break into that phone and check it out. Now, dismissed the whole case against Apple, trying to force Apple to actually write this code. So that ended up going away. And that was only for that specific phone. So what's happening now is that, you know, there are different tech companies that are on one side or on the other. Y'all do what the feds say, and others are like, no, we're going to protect our customers, because if you don't, you may end up not having a business eventually, because customers will go away if they don't feel safe. Okay, so it's gotten all of Silicon Valley and other tech hubs all in a stir about what they're going to do, because it's not going to be the only time. The feds had other cases too already that were in court to hack, you know, hack into criminals' phones. And so it's going to come around again. So in one of my go-to sources, the Washington Post, Elizabeth Dwoskin did a piece on a thing called the switch, and it's the title of the article is "What's Driving Silicon Valley to Become Radicalized." Okay, so I'm just gonna run through really quick. I don't have a lot of time, but I just want you to. I'm doing this because you need to know what's going on in the background to try and keep you secure and not create easy open doors for hackers to actually get into your phone when you're unsuspecting. Okay, so like many Silicon Valley startups, Larry Gadea's company collects heaps of sensitive data from his customers. Okay, so let me stop right there. That's why this got my attention. Okay, we're on the internet incessantly. I could, you know, give you statistics, but I won't, you know, go there with that. But we're on, you know, websites, you know, incessantly, and data is constantly being collected. Okay, and especially if you don't clear your cookies and trash your cookies, okay, that's a whole nother conversation, or clear your cache, you know, especially for websites that you don't go to that often, there's always this back, and you know, that's the nature of the internet. It's the back and forth in collecting data. We give it up freely, and then other times, because it's just hanging out there in cyberspace, it's gotten. So, you know, and that's the nature of a lot of these businesses. So Larry has a business. Okay, and so recently he decided to do something that with that data trove that was long considered unthinkable. Okay, and let me back up a minute too, because when we're going to websites, and this happens a lot with emails, if you click on a website and an email, if you took the time to really look at the web browser window that comes up and look in the URL in the address bar, the website that you thought you were clicking on isn't the first website address that comes up. And what happens is they're data collectors, and there are advertising aggregators who you go to their site first so they can grab that data. Then they send you on to the website that you intended to go to. And a lot of those, they're being paid by the website that you're being sent to collect that information, because the number of times that you go to that website or where you go is data that they can use to entice advertisers to advertise on their site, because they're showing how many numbers, how many times people, you know, go to their website, and they sell that, and you know, that's how they make money. And so Larry has a company that does exactly that. He collects this data. Okay, so he is doing something that's unthinkable for a company that makes their money on collecting data. Okay, and that is, he is getting rid of it. The reason? Gadea fears that one day the FBI might do to him what it did to Apple in their recent legal battle, demand that he give the agency access to his encrypted data. Rather than make what he considers a Faustian bargain, he's building a system that he hopes will avoid the situation entirely. Okay, so he says, we have to keep as little information as possible so that even if the government or some other entity wanted access to it, we'd be able to say that we don't have it. He's the founder and chief executive of Envoy, E-N-V-O-Y. The 30-person company enables businesses to register visitors using iPads instead of handwritten visitor logs. Okay, so you know when you go to a workshop or a conference, or even a meeting, and you know, we pass that, you have to go and fill out one of, actually I had one over there in my bag. And they want you to fill out your name, your email, your phone number, and you have to handwrite it. And then we on the other side, we can't read your writing, but we're collecting that information. Well, now he's written software and making a business out of it, of actually taking an iPad and having people to actually, you know, sign in there. And then what it will probably do is to take that handwriting and convert it into zeros and ones, into bits, into data, so it's text. Okay, which is a smart thing to do. I wish I'd have thought about doing that as a business. Yeah, you beat me to it. Okay, so the technology tracks who works at a firm, who visits the firm, and their contact information. So actually what he's doing is more when you go into an office building and you have to sign in that you're entering this building, and again, like a hospital or an office building, and you have to sign in, you have to sign your name in, who you're going to see, what floor, the date, time. Okay, so he's actually created software that will do that, and it gets done on an iPad. Okay, so the whole nature of how you sign in on stuff is like changing quickly as well. And that's all going into the digital realm. Okay, so in Silicon Valley, there's a new emphasis on putting up barriers to government requests for data. The Apple FBI case and its aftermath have tech firms racing to employ a variety of tools that will place customer information beyond the reach of a government-ordered search. Okay, so the trend is a striking reversal of a long-standing article of faith in the data-hungry tech industry, where companies including Google and the latest startups have predicated success on the ability to hoover up as much information as possible. So just look at what Google does, okay? And any search engine, their whole, the whole you know, idea of search is that you have this huge big data. Remember, I did a show on big data. Database, this really huge big data database that gets called upon to drop information instantly when you ask for it. So now, okay, so that kind of gives you an idea of where, how things are kind of reversing and changing. So here's another quote from him. Engineers are not inherently anti-government, but they are becoming radicalized because they believe that the FBI in particular and the U.S. government more broadly wants to outlaw encryption. They're thinking that that's the end game with the feds and with the government is to, and in like some countries, you cannot encrypt, and they have the on-off switch to the internet in a lot of countries. Okay, we don't have that in the United States yet. But because of these different issues coming up, they're feeling like eventually they'll want to eliminate encryption altogether. And that for us means that we'll be insecure and it'll cause us to back off using stuff. Okay, and right now that's going the wrong direction. Because now they'll charge you a fee with some of our utility companies if you actually get a paper bill. If you don't go online to pay your bill, then they'll charge you. So, you know, we can't go backwards now. The elephant is in the room. Okay, so actually that quote was from a very prominent venture capitalist. Sorry, that was from Mark Andreessen, who started Netscape. Okay, he founded Netscape. And that's what he contends that the government is looking towards going. So even though they abandoned their effort to force Apple to help unlock that iPhone, they're saying that the issue is far from settled. Like I said, it is far from settled and will probably be the subject of other court and legislative battles. So a lot of the new startup companies, they don't have any skin in the game yet. They're new. So when they design their interfaces, they can now design that with in mind and come up with ways that, because they're so smart, there's a lot of brain power out there. They can come up with ways where they can capture the data and make use of it and have it have an expiration. I think one of the popular apps out there, is it Snapchat? Mm-hmm. Snapchat is based on why a lot of people are going to it is that normally anything that you put on the internet has a forever life. Okay, it's there forever because it's going to be on somebody's server somewhere for eternity. That's why I said if you had any extra money, you want to invest in a SSD or a server company because we're going to have servers for a long, long time. So it's going to be there someplace. So Snapchat has figured out, well, you put your message on there and you put whatever you're on there and then it expires in 24 hours, is it, Dawn?
Yep.
I haven't started using Snapchat yet.
Yeah,
I finally downloaded. Yeah, but if you don't save it within the 24 hours, it's gone.
Supposedly.
Okay, so obviously there's a way to build in using the data, putting an expiration on it, and then it actually gets trashed. So I wanted to tell you that because there are people that are really, really working to keep us secure. But as I mentioned, you got to help yourself too, and you got to be proactive. And those are the tools that I will continue to bring you. But at the same time, have us still function because now we're addicts. We're all addicts to this. Now some we can't get away from using the internet, our smartphones, and just we need to just be cognizant of how that's happening. Okay, I am going to throw in another song. Okay, I am going to do some music so you can ingest that and then I'll be right back. Okay, Dawn, skip to The Way You Move. Okay, I'm skipping around in my playlist a little bit. Okay, Zenobia here, the Touchable Tech Diva. I'm making technology and it's Silicon Valley radicalizing touchable and how it applies to your life here at Tech Diva and the Luxury Lifestyle, Tech Tools, Toys, News, Hot Jazz, Passionate Living. Be back in a bit.
like this.
Thank you.
Got to give it up. Marvin Gaye made that famous. Remember? Dom wasn't here when that came out. Anyway, okay, so that was Urban Nights. Okay, so Urban Nights, Best of Urban Nights, and then prior to that, The Way You Move, and that was Earth, Wind, and Fire featuring Kenny G. And so we were just talking about Outkast made this really, really popular in the 21st century, okay, but Earth, Wind, and Fire originally did it back in the late 70s. So, yeah, good songs always resurface, and that's why I like to do this jazz cover show. So I gotta hurry up, but I wanted to do this. Okay, just one more cybersecurity story. Okay, a lot of us are on LinkedIn because we like it for business reasons, and LinkedIn must have maybe 200 million users across the globe. Well, this came out just a little while ago. Let me see. Oh, I captured this May 25th. This was just a couple of weeks ago. And I heard about this, and I was waiting to get the email from LinkedIn. But this is from USA Today Tech, and Elizabeth Weiss. I'm not sure if I pronounced their names right, but I give them full credit because they did the writing. Okay. Okay, millions of LinkedIn users told to change your password. So when you get this, when you see this kind of stuff, sometimes you just, it's like a blip and it just goes by you. But then you have to come back to it. I had to come back to it, and I actually like printed this out. And I'm like, oh, really? Because that kind of catches my attention. Okay, so as many as 100 million users on LinkedIn began getting emails Thursday. Well, this was prior to May 25th, the Thursday prior to that, telling them to change their passwords. And I'm like, well, I didn't get the email yet. Okay, so what is that really about? And so Elizabeth says they should. Earlier in that week, this is only like a couple of weeks ago, so it's not that old. Okay, this is not that old. Okay, earlier that week, the website Motherboard, a website called Motherboard, I love it. I'm gonna have to make that one of my go-tos too. Reported that a hacker going by the name of Peace, P-E-A-C-E, Peace, wreaking havoc, was looking to sell emails and passwords for 117 million LinkedIn users stolen in a 2012 breach. Okay, so whoever Peace was, somehow, now, it doesn't say that Peace did the breach, but it said that 117 million LinkedIn user passwords and emails were stolen in 2012. Okay, now, you know how things move very quickly, and it's 2016. That was 4 years ago that this breach happened with LinkedIn. I can't remember that happening or LinkedIn saying to change our passwords, but I think I do remember having to change my LinkedIn password. Okay, and so the asking price, so he's trying to sell this for a mere $2,200. That's not very much money. Okay, that's not very much. Okay, so at the time of the 2012 hack, LinkedIn believed about 6.5 million usernames and passwords from them were effective, but it turns out it was like over 100 million. Okay, so I don't have time to go through this, but so they started contacting, and I think like after I copied this story or printed out this story, a few days later, I did get the email to change my password. So any of you that are on LinkedIn, we're supposed to change our passwords anyway. You know, I did the password inundation and password management show. We are supposed to change our passwords more frequently. So if you haven't, then I suggest that you go and change your LinkedIn password. Okay, real quickly, something on a much lighter note. One of the technologies that's getting a lot of attention is VR, virtual reality. And that's, with the goggles, and we see 360. And a lot of you have gone to the movies, and now a lot of the movies are done in 3D. Well, there's the expectation that 9 million VR headsets are going to be shipped this year. This article came out April 22nd. So between now and then the end of the year, you're going to buy 9 million VR headsets. So here's a quick clip of me actually at the Consumer Electronics Show trying on a VR headset. Okay. Okay, Don's queuing that up. Okay, so anyway, and last week, a couple of weeks ago, I went to, okay, so here it goes, and I'll tell you later.
Do you want to come over around?
Okay.
Yeah. Discovery Network booth.
And tell me what I'm trying on.
So this is Discovery VR, which stands for virtual reality. This is the Discovery Channel taking it to a whole other level.
Okay, so now tell me what I need to do.
So what you're going to do is you're going to put this on and make sure the straps fit you, adjust the focus.
Okay. Oops. Because that was a little too tight. Oh, interesting.
So, yeah, I'll just adjust the straps here.
Taking you to
I think they're
new
a little
world.
Too tight here.
Turns out my head's not that small.
It's pretty tight on the other side.
Okay.
That's good?
Yes.
Okay,
so I see words and stuff happening.
Okay, you ready for the earphones?
I'm ready for the earphones.
Okay, look up, down, and all around, look behind you and everywhere.
Oh, okay. Oh, the giraffe is about to kiss me. And so is an elephant. Okay. Oh, my hometown. That's the crookedest street in the world, San Francisco.
Yeah.
Okay, from a skateboarder's perspective.
Start turning around and looking down.
Okay. Oh, man. All right, this is kind of interesting. It's got all kinds of cool little clips that give a lot of dimension. Okay, so now I'm on the water. Now I'm underwater, swimming with the sharks. That's very cool. Okay, very good.
Yes. Okay, so this is your upcoming form of entertainment, taking entertainment to another level. And the thing is, what she was saying for me to walk around, to move around and turn around, because there's content that goes on behind, but I was, the dimensions are so incredibly intense because it's like super, it's UHD level that, I wasn't into like turning around a whole lot because I didn't want to lose my balance and fall over. But a lot of times you can see commercials and see people wearing these and you see them jumping and they're just standing in an empty room, right? Well, it's very true because it does get you engaged. So anyway, I went to a Society of Motion Picture and Television Engineers special meeting about VR because they're like totally investing. A lot of these companies, they are gonna get you to wear these VR helmets. Okay, so I've run out of time and I'll be back next time. Do your homework, go here, watch some live music someplace. I'll have more stuff for you coming up and enjoy the rest of your week, okay? Tech Diva, the Luxury Lifestyle, Zenobia here, curating tech tools, toys, news, hot jazz, passionate living. See you next time. Take care.